The early nuclear weapons storage sites typically contained approximately 40 to 50 buildings, including the igloos within the fenced storage area. The entire complex was surrounded by a series of high, chain-link fences, one of which was electrified, topped with strands of barbed wire on outriggers, as well as by patrol and maintenance roads. Key buildings within the Q area were the A and A-2 structures, the B structure, the C structure, the assembly plants 1 and 2, A and B, the command and control building, the S structure, and the storage igloos. The facility usually developed in three phases. During the initial phase, the Q areas had a minimal administrative group of buildings near the main entrance gate, with an underground command post, a weapons area with emergency power plant, and buried radioactive dump sites. A semi-hardened, multipart assembly plant interconnected by an underground vestibule, two plants, 1 and 2, also referenced as A and B. An isolated, detonators, also known as pits or initiators, storage building. Known as the A structure. A checkout building for the stored bomb components, known as the C structure, and the igloo storage area. From 1954 to 1957, the government expanded the Q area's administrative components, which provided greater hardening of the command and control buildings, and the articulation of their multiple communications links, and added a special weapons crew building at the assembly plant. Key additions to the Q areas included the second-generation nuclear capsule storage buildings, the A2s, which were substantially bermed or underground, and the S structure used to conduct another level of quality assurance activities for weapon disassembly and maintenance. From 1959 to 1960, Q areas expanded their assembly plants to accommodate new nuclear weapons technologies, also adding laboratory facilities for heavy metal studies at some locations. To understand Q area facilities, and their Cold War missions, one must understand the basics of nuclear weapons and the buildings and activities of an operational Q area. The earliest atomic weapons are considered fission bombs, where a slightly subcritical mass of radioactive material, primarily plutonium, becomes critical by imploding the material, creating an almost instantaneous chain reaction, by bombarding the molecular nuclei with neutrons, causing them to split, and releasing large amounts of energy, a process called fission. The spherical mass of plutonium is also called the capsule or pit. The implosion is created by detonating carefully formed lenses of explosive material that surrounds the spherical mass. To successfully initiate fission, the pit was not only compressed, but additional neutrons were introduced to start the reaction. This was accomplished by inserting an initiator into the center of the capsule. Generally, the capsules were stored separately from the explosive component of the weapon, and were not inserted until the bomb was needed. While in storage, the capsules required regular maintenance. The spherical mass of plutonium would oxidize and required cleaning. Additionally, the early initiators used polonium and beryllium. To accomplish this required maintenance, each storage site had specialized buildings to store the capsules and perform necessary maintenance. At the early National Stockpile sites, the facilities were a combination of underground and above-ground buildings. Referred to as Plant 1, all facilities needed for maintenance of the weapons, inert storage, administrative areas, break and change rooms, emergency generators, and support facilities were located deep within the mountainside. The work areas and interconnecting tunnels were of reinforced concrete with vertical side walls and arched roofs, very similar in appearance to an earth-covered igloo magazine. The primary nuclear component of an atomic bomb and the primary stage of a thermonuclear bomb was the capsule or pit that made up the majority of the weapon's special nuclear material. In gun-type weapons, the capsule was two masses of uranium located at a critically safe distance at either end of the barrel, and in early implosion weapons the capsule was the single mass of plutonium that was mechanically compressed to create a supercritical mass. Because the overwhelming majority of atomic weapons created during the Cold War were implosion type, and specialized facilities were constructed at the storage sites to maintain these capsules, the remainder of this program will focus on plutonium pits. As previously noted, the surface of the sphere had a tendency to oxidize in storage, so a routine maintenance activity was periodically wiping down the exterior with organic solvents. The interior of the capsule had a hollow cavity that was accessed by unscrewing a threaded plutonium plug that was machined into the sphere. This cavity held the second nuclear component, the initiator. As the name implies, initiators supplied neutrons to initiate a nuclear chain reaction. For a chain reaction to occur, neutrons must be present at the exact time that they are needed, in order to achieve a nuclear explosion. In early implosion-type weapons, this timing was achieved by placing the initiator in the heart of the core. Early nuclear weapons used polonium-beryllium initiators to produce the neutrons required for a fission chain reaction. Locating the initiators in the center of the nuclear core ensured that the neutrons were available when they were needed. While the polonium-beryllium initiators were very effective, they produced major maintenance problems because polonium isotope, polonium-210, had a half-life of 138 days. As a result, every nuclear capsule in the stockpile had to have its initiator replaced on a regular schedule. Later generation weapons had electronic initiators that greatly reduced the maintenance and surveillance requirements. Storage of capsules took place in facilities referred to as A-structures. Special security measures were incorporated into the construction of Plant 1 and the areas used for storage of capsules. These included heavy bank-type vault doors. Additional security for the nuclear material was provided by each door having two combination locks. No single person knew both combinations. This level of security was required to prevent tampering with the capsules, but also because it was reported that the manufacture of plutonium made up a significant part of the nation's gross national product in the early 1950s. Each cell measures approximately 10 feet wide, 13 feet long, and 9 feet high. The cells are fitted with steel shelves where the nuclear material was stored. The capsules were contained within steel cylinders supported by a steel framework referred to as a bird cage. The bird cages were specially designed to maintain a safe distance between each plutonium sphere. If the materials were placed too close together, they may approach a critical state. Each cell could hold about 30 capsules contained in individual bird cages. Periodically, each capsule was removed from the A structure and taken to a maintenance facility called a C structure. Each lab originally had wooden benches where the maintenance work was performed. Maintenance of the capsule included carefully removing it from its container, placing a plexiglass glove box over the capsule, and then unscrewing a plug of machined plutonium from the sphere. The initiator was then removed from the core of the capsule and a new one inserted. The plug was put back into place and the sphere cleaned of any oxidation. The initiators were manufactured at Sandia Labs in New Mexico, and the used items were packaged and returned to the lab for refurbishment. To ensure the viability of the nuclear core, it was necessary to periodically measure the intensity of the nuclear material with a radioactive source. Known as sources, these contained neutron-emitting radioactive materials, that when moved closer to the plutonium sphere, would excite the plutonium sphere, and a Geiger counter could monitor the activity. While many C structures contained floor safes to secure the sources, Plant 1 shows no indication of a source safe, and it is possible that a movable device was used. After maintenance, the capsule was placed back in its cylinder within the bird cage, the lid secured with a lead seal, and the container pressurized with inert gas. It was then transported back to the A structure. Sealed initiators, developed between 1954 and 1957, replaced the polonium-beryllium type and lessened maintenance on capsules to annual inspections. By 1962, capsules themselves were phased out of the nuclear stockpile, and C structures were no longer used. Q areas also contained buildings for the maintenance of the non-nuclear components of the weapons. These were located in other rooms of Plant 1. Tritium boosters. In 1951, scientists at the Los Alamos Laboratory successfully demonstrated the principle of boosting. Boosting is the enhancement of a fission weapon's performance by more fully exploiting the neutrons released in thermonuclear reactions produced within the weapon's core. Boosting of fission reactions was a key step in the development of thermonuclear weapons and gave weapon designers the ability to produce smaller and lighter weight weapons. Boosting is produced by injecting tritium gas into the fission reaction. This gas increases the fission yield and thereby supplies the energy required to initiate the fusion reaction in thermonuclear weapons. Boosting was such an important aspect of nuclear weapon designs from the early 1950s onward. The Atomic Energy Commission established the Savannah River site in South Carolina to produce the tritium gas. All or almost all thermonuclear weapons in the nation's stockpile used a boosted primary design, and some atomic bombs in the stockpile were designed or modified to take advantage of boosting to increase their yield. The tritium boosters used in atomic and thermonuclear weapons were specially designed gas cylinders and gas transfer mechanisms, not altogether unlike those used in welding and other industries. The extreme temperatures and pressures that the high-pressure storage and transfer systems were exposed to in the initial stages of the fission reaction require extremely robust engineering. Designing, developing, and engineering these booster systems was a major achievement in the history of nuclear weaponization. Prior to the mid-1950s, all atomic and thermonuclear weapons required extensive maintenance and surveillance to ensure that they would be ready when needed. In 1956, the first sealed pit warhead, the W-25, entered the stockpile. Sealed pit weapons were a milestone in atomic weapon development, because they did not require the extensive surveillance and maintenance of early generation weapons. As a class, sealed pit weapons were termed wooden bombs, because they could sit on a shelf like a piece of wood, needing no attention until its use was required. Sealed pit weapons were particularly important to the wide variety of nuclear weapon delivery systems, particularly missiles, which the United States came to rely on as the Cold War progressed. In fact, the first sealed pit warhead to enter the stockpile, the W-25, was designed for the Genie air-to-air missile system. While it was possible to have weapons that required extensive maintenance and surveillance when the nation's nuclear stockpile was comprised exclusively of gravity bombs stored in relatively few confined storage areas, it became a practical impossibility to have high-maintenance warheads mounted on missiles aboard submarines or in silos dispersed over a wide geographic area. The effectiveness of these missile systems depended on warheads that could be put in place and left unattended for months or years on end.